So we're going to just dive right in. I'm going to give you, you know, the space to take up as much or as little space with your responses as you'd like. We're going to start with an intro, and then we're just going to dive into our conversation.
Sounds good.
Okay. All right. So thank you again for saying yes to being a part of this podcast. I'm super grateful. Shout out to Podmatch for, you know, pairing us and seeing some similarities in the things that we're both interested in. So I'm super grateful for that. And I just want to give you a chance now to introduce yourself to the listeners and the viewers just by sharing your name, where you're from, and what you stand for.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for having me. This is awesome. My name is Manuela Powell. I am living in Austin, Texas. I'm from Rio, and I stand for women knowing how amazingly powerful they are. This is my deal.
I love that. Women knowing how amazing we are. I just was in a digital or virtual workshop about 30 minutes ago, and it's with this organization that's actually all women, entrepreneurs, professional speakers, and so on. And there's just a collective space where women can come and offer their knowledge, their wisdom, or their special skill set to others, everything from marketing to financial literacy, and of course, health and wellness. And every time I go into one of the workshops, I'm just really excited to know, like, I'm in a space with like 250 other really badass women, and we're teaching each other really cool skills. So I'll send you a link for that, and you can definitely check it out, because you might have, you know, some expertise to kind of offer there. So before we actually sit down and have our podcast recording, I always like to send my guests a little questionnaire. And so what I really like about it is that it gives me a chance to kind of get to know people a little bit. And I know that you're a mom and you have two boys. I see their pictures in the background. Hello, boys. So I also recognize that you're a mindset coach for moms. Can you tell me a little bit more about how you got into that type of work and, you know, what it's like being in that space?
Sure, I'd love to. So my career actually started as a doctor. I used to be a breast cancer surgeon. So I've been around women in their very vulnerable times for my whole life, basically. When I had my kids, I was mature, let's say. I had my first at 42 and my second at 44. They're 4 and 6 now. And I was living in Brazil, where I'm from. And we decided to move to the US. We knew we were going to move here because my husband's from here. And I didn't want to go back to working 15-hour days and not having any control over my time. I wanted to see my kids. I saw my colleagues just having no time for their families, not seeing their kids for several days, not, God forbid, like watching a game or doing whatever kind of stuff, you know, we do as parents.
Right.
So I was like, I don't want to be like that. I want to be there. I'm going to drop them off at school and pick them up and all that. And if they're sick, I want to be home. And obviously I couldn't do that as a surgeon. So I made the hard decision to quit. It was a hard decision, but one that I do not regret. But then, you know, then we moved here and I had a two-year-old and a 2-month-old. So that was fun, an overseas move with, you know, a newborn and a toddler. And for a while, I had no idea what I was going to do. I was just wallowing in that, what should I do with my life? Because I was so fulfilled. I actually loved being a surgeon. And I was like, how am I going to find something that's going to just fulfill my soul like that did? And after a good year, my husband was like, hey, why don't you find a coach? And I had no idea about life coaching. I was like, what are you talking about? I don't even play sports. Why would I need a coach?
Right.
He's like, no, a life coach. So I was like, oh, I don't know what that is. That sounds like a scam or something. So I went to search it. And as soon as I started reading about it, I was like, oh my God, this is what I have to do with my life. And he was very like, whoa, wait, that's not what I meant. I meant hire a coach. I did hire a coach. I had like 2 sessions with a career coach, and what I figured out was that I really loved, of course, operating. But the second thing I loved about my profession was to talk to women whose life now has completely changed. And, you know, a lot of times they were young women, like in their 40s, sometimes even earlier, they had done everything right. They were eating, they were exercising, right, and all that stuff. And here they are with cancer. And breast cancer is super curable disease. It's amazing the progress that even in my lifetime has been made. Mm-hmm. But still, it's a diagnosis that will slap you in the face and
of course
just change everything. So I'd love to have those conversations and kind of help them navigate to their new normal. So mm-hmm. I was like, mean, I wasn't coaching them per se, but I can see that how that would be completely what I meant to do.
Right.
And here we are.
Right. You know, it's interesting because when I started coaching, it was after working in sales and technology and pretty much what I say, like a high paying job, also a very highly stressful job for a really well-known company. And I recognized that a lot of the conversations I was having with people, even though the focus was sales, I was really kind of getting to know people and really enjoyed getting to know people and recognized that that was something that I really am energized by, is being able to make new and valuable and conscious connections with folks. And when I left that job, it was after an extended family member had passed away very suddenly. And there was a moment where I kind of did that, whoa, let me reevaluate my life, what's actually going on with me, and am I really doing something that I feel like is purposeful? And one day I saw this meme on Facebook, and it was a little picture of like two little, you know, stick figures talking to each other. And one person says, "What do you do?" And they said, "Oh, I'm a this, I'm a that, I'm a lawyer, I'm a this." And I said, "No, no, no. What are you doing to change the world?" And it was just like one little meme, two little sentences. And I was like, oh my God, what am I doing to change the world? How am I making a contribution to the world? Am I just selling technology? Like, technology is great, but how am I really making an impact on the world? And so it was a moment for me to really take a pause and really evaluate. And I remember the day that I left my job and I just said, today's going to be my last day. I didn't put in 2 weeks notice. I was just like, this is done. Like the surge to move was so powerful that I knew I could not walk back into that building and do it again. And after I left that job, a sister friend of mine said, come and take a yoga class. You've been stressed out for years. I'm watching you run yourself ragged. Come take a class. And I said, okay, sure. Yoga, workout, whatever. No problem. I go take this class and I have the full like yoga meltdown, you know, on my mat. I'm in Shavasana and I'm just like weeping, like, oh my God, this is what I needed. So it really was a way for me to explore a deeper connection with myself as a woman, as a person, as a mother as well. My son will be 20 years old in a couple of weeks now. And I didn't realize that while I was working so hard to build a good life for him, I was missing out on so much of his good life. And so, you know, it was a moment for me to say like, whoa, okay.
Yeah. I think you touched on something that's really, you know, the other part of the job that I now do, which is working with moms, which has nothing to do with anything related to medicine. And a lot of people would say when I became a coach, people were like, oh, are you going to work for doctors, patients, nurses, whatever? Mm-hmm. I was like, no, nothing like that. And I decided to work with women, especially moms, because I think it's so real for us that even if we were this badass woman, which, you know, I was a surgeon, a firefighter, I was always like doing whatever I wanted and what I like, you know, was intimidating and all those things. And then now I was like, wait, here I am being a servant to literally everyone. And I can't take time off. I can't do things. This is all in my head, obviously, because of course I can't do all these things, but we're conditioned to think all these things.
Right.
And you have to go, 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 and you have to be perfect. And, you know, have to do the Pinterest birthday and the house has to be squeaky clean and you have to be beautiful and your job, whatever, like all the things, which is completely impossible. And so right. I noticed that I was like, I think this is a really important thing because we don't know ourselves at all. Like most of us, like you said, like you lie, at some point you lie down on a yoga mat and you're like, oh, wait, what is going on? Who is this person?
Right.
And you just realize so many things were implanted in your brain just because of culture and all the stuff that we live, the society we live in. And, you know, once you realize that you actually don't have to do all these things and you can actually do something different, you're a much better mom.
Yeah.
Your kids are just so much happier. Right. And even if you work, like, you know, people might be, oh, you know, you're only about a good mom if you're like a stay-at-home mom. And you take it. I'm not a stay-at-home mom. I don't want to be. I was during the pandemic, obviously, like all.
Right.
And I hated it. And I still don't want to. If that's what you lights your soul, go for it. Amazing. More power to you. But I don't think it's necessarily give up all your life and live your kids' lives. it's the opposite. It's go live your life and show your kids that they can also do that instead of just, you know, perpetuate it. I'm going to sacrifice for my kids, and then they're going to grow up and they're going to sacrifice for their kids and so on and so forth for eternity. That doesn't make sense at all. Like, what are we doing for the world if we're doing that, right?
Exactly. It ends up creating like just a continuing cycle of, as women, setting ourselves aside and saying, well, I'm setting myself aside for the sake of my children. So that makes me an amazing woman, right? And for some women, that is their reality. That is their truth. But there's so many women that are saying, I'm actually going to set myself in front so that I can actually be a better person and therefore a better parent and therefore a better mom, et cetera. And I think it's more, it seems like there's an awakening, you know, that's happening. Like, my mom is in her 60s and she's a mom of 5 kids. And she definitely, I watched her set herself aside for the sake of us. And then as we matured into adulthood, I started watching her give herself some of that attention, you know, taking herself out for nice meals and going.
That happens a lot. Like, we wait until that time. Instead of, even if you're a stay-at-home mom, like, that doesn't mean that your life has to be just about the kids, right? Because, like, it's I think, especially if you're a stay-at-home mom, because that is the hardest job I can think of. I'm not good at it at all. Like, I sucked at it. And if I didn't know that already, which I did, the pandemic definitely improved it. But even if that's what you do, like, taking care of your kids is the whole thing. You have to fill your cup first, and you know, having hobbies or things you're interested in. So it's not, we don't have to be around our kids. I mean, of course, sometimes around, of course, because they're young, but like, if they're, you know, like, we don't have to cater to them the whole time. We can have some time to do our things, and taking time to not be around them. And during the pandemic, we did that a lot because we had to work. So it was like, yeah, we're going to go to the backyard. And like, you're not allowed to talk to me for 30 minutes. There's a backyard. There's all these things that you guys can play and just go and figure it out. You cannot talk to me. And of course, at the beginning, you go, wah, wah, wah. And 5 minutes later, they're like finding rocks and whatever. And then they forgot I existed. So we think we have to do all these things and give them this magical childhood, when in reality, if we're feeling good about ourselves, it's going to be way more magical for them, because we're going to be happy. And, you know, that's going to be their compass from then on. It's totally different.
Right. And it really, I think, encourages them to be self-reliant, you know, and self-sufficient, and to know that, yes, as their parents, I think we automatically take on the responsibility to protect and provide for them, you know, their needs, et cetera. But when it comes to really developing a sense of like self-sufficiency versus codependency, I think really starts with the way that we mom, you know, the way that we parent. And so letting kids know, hey, you know, I was a single mom, I would say a pseudo single mom. I went through a divorce when my son was 4 years old. And then we had, you know, joint custody for several years, but there was a bulk of the time where he was primarily with me. And there were days where I'd say, son, I need the next 2 hours. You're good. You know, like, snacks are in the fridge. You can either watch like a little bit of TV, or you can go play outside. I can keep an eye on you, but I need some me time, some mom time, and not waiting until I was at like my wit's end, ready to pull my hair out, but really like making that a priority, you know? And I think that the more that moms are encouraged to do that and to recognize that it's actually very valuable for them to take really great care of themselves, and know that, like you said, creating a magical childhood. I don't think any of us had a magical childhood, you know, and even, I don't even know what that is, right? And I don't know if that exists outside of like a Disney movie, you know what I mean? Yeah. I don't know if that's a real thing. Yeah. And I think we hold ourselves to these expectations, you know, that in a lot of ways were, I would say, influenced by patriarchal mindsets and thinking that said, well, this is a woman's place and this is what a woman is supposed to do. I think that we're breaking out of some of that belief, and we're changing the narrative of what motherhood looks like, and recognizing that it doesn't have to be to the exclusion of the woman in order to be a great mom at all.
Yeah.
So I have a question for you. I know one of the things that I like to ask in the questionnaire is, you know, share an area of interest that really resonates with you. And you shared smashing the patriarchy mindset. I was like, hell yeah. Tell me more about that. Tell me a little more about what that means for you and what that
Yeah, so it's a little bit of what you just said is we all have internalized patriarchal ideas. We grew up in a society, doesn't matter where you grew up, if you grew up in this century or the last century, I guess, you know, that's our reality everywhere. There's no culture that I know of where women are free to do whatever they want and they're in control and all that stuff. That just doesn't exist. And not only, you know, men, like I live in Texas. So for instance, here, basically just a bunch of white men just banned abortions basically, which is insane, but here we are living this reality. And on the other side, watching all these messages from the media that if you don't dress this way, drink this brand, wear this thing, and you know, if you don't, I don't know, if you don't drink pumpkin spice latte, you're not a whole person or something like that. Like there are all these things that are absolutely not true, but yeah, we believe them. So I have clients, for instance, that were amazing professionals and all that, and then the pandemic hit. And automatically it was like, well, my husband kept working and I went to take care of the kids, which is like, right, is a very patriarchal thing. And it doesn't have to be like that. Many of them, some of them actually made more money, but it, even if they continued to work, it's like, oh, this is my, this is my, or when you hear people, I hear this so much because my husband is a super good dad. And I hear a lot, I was like, oh, he helps you so much. I'm like, oh, what? It's freaking his job too. It's not my job and he's being so nice and helping me. Like, what is happening? So these kind of things are things that even if you're a super badass, you have these ideas in your mind. And then that will inform everything, the way that you're going to behave in the world. Mm-hmm. So what I love to do with my clients, in my content, whatever, in any conversation I have, is whenever I hear those things, you know, for instance, women say, oh yeah, I can't do that because blah, blah, blah. And it's usually some version of, you know, I have to be everything for everyone. And so I can't. Mm-hmm. And when a lot of times, like, why did you have to do that? You can leave your house to be a mess. You can leave the dishes on the sink for a day. It's fine. You don't have to do, you know, decorate your house like the Pinterest cover thing. Like, you don't have to do all these things. Mm-hmm. If you love doing that, oh my God, go for it. Crazy. I never in my life, like my kids' birthdays are just like, hey, here's a cake. Yay, happy birthday. And then, you know, I don't like doing all that stuff. It's not my jam. Like I could call their friends to come here. Before the pandemic, we had one that was like, we all to watch an improv kids show. And it was so fun. It's just like, let's all go. And like, you know, not, this is like super low profile. I don't have to do anything, but everybody had so much fun. Instead of, so-and-so had this party with the scenes that I have to do. And this is such a silly example, but it's something that can get really stressful if you add to all the things you're supposed to do. And then, oh, I have to volunteer at school because obviously, you know, first thing that I did when my kids started school, I'm like, I am not going to do anything. You guys need any help, like financial help, I will help you, but do not ever count on me coming here to volunteer in class. If I have to, sure, I'll do it. But I don't want to do it, you know? And there are people who love doing that.
Yeah.
I feel like it's just like, there are going to be people to fill those roles. And I think the more that we know ourselves, realize what is it that I want and just what you want, not what you and other people to want from you. Right. So that is the thing that I love doing. And of course, there's the actual patriarchy out there, like the legislator in Texas, we're banning abortions. And for that, you know, Saturday, we're going to go march. But like, that's one thing. But my favorite thing is to do that with the internalized one, because that is so much harder. Like, even if we get all of the external stuff fixed, we're still gonna have that, oh yeah, I'm gonna work, or I'm gonna take care of the kids and he's gonna work because that's more my job, because I don't know, I might made them. Like, I don't, you already made them. Like, don't you deserve some back now?
Oh my God. I'm over here like, yes, yes, yes to everything you said. Cause I was that mom. I was a young mom. I had my son when I was 24 and I was, you know, just fresh a couple years out of college and just kind of still figuring life out, you know, in hindsight, I'm like, what did I know at 24 to be somebody's mom? And I remember even at that age, feeling that pressure when I, you know, when he went to pre-K or to kindergarten, went to school, and they send home this like community service hours, like worksheet for the parents to like fill out and commit to doing a certain number of hours. And I'm thinking, I'm working 40 hours a week. you know, I, my son's in school. I have two jobs. Like, when am I going to come and freaking volunteer? And isn't that why I brought him here? So you guys can teach him. Like, I get it. Like, continuing education at home, I understand all that is very valuable, but like, I thought that was kind of the whole point of bringing him to school. And so I was that mom too, you know? And then when he got involved in extracurriculars, you know, I would see the moms, because my kid was a theater kid. And so I'd see all these moms who were just like at the theater 24/7. They're always there. They're bringing the snacks. They're bringing the this, they're working the snack bar at all the shows. And I'm like, I can only come to two shows. There's five. I can only come to two. I'm going to be in the front row. I'm going to be the loudest one in the audience. I'm going to take the pictures, make the video, and then I have to go back to work or I have to go to sleep because I'm tired. Or I have to go do something for myself. I'm going to go to a retreat. So I think that if more moms could start to smash that patriarchy mindset, I swear I'm going to borrow that and I'm going to give you credit for it. But, you know, smashing that patriarchy mindset in the minds of mothers in particular, oh my God, especially when we're raising boys.
Yes, I love that you say that, because a lot of times, and I also have two boys, so it's, a lot of people say, oh, you know, because I have a daughter. Like, and of course, we need to raise daughters to be badasses. But I think, honestly, I think if we just like don't mess with that, like it's, we're going to be fine. We just have to stop putting all the stupid ideas in their minds. But if you don't do that, it's going to be okay. But what I notice is the thing is so ingrained in our society that when my youngest was about 3 years old, he goes to this daycare that's super progressive, inclusive. Like, you know, they're no, like, of course, boys can dress as princesses and they paint their nails and whatever. Like, there's no, you know, like gender, like there's a lot of very diverse, non-binary, trans, like teachers. It's awesome.
Yeah.
And so when he was around three, he was playing with his car and it was like, oh, so this is the daddy and he's going to work. And I had the other car and I was like, oh, and so the mommy's going to work too. And he's like, stopped my hand. I was like, no, the mommy doesn't go to work. I was like, oh, why doesn't she? I was like, she doesn't have the power to go to work. I was like, oh, what? Excuse me, sir. Number one, what are you talking? What is happening right now? And, you know, I even laughed because I was like, this is great. Because how can, where did this come from? Like, he is here in this house and then he is at school. But somehow I don't know, Disney movies and whatever, cartoons, just like life in general, that's just how it is. It's just so insanely ingrained. And here's like, he has a mom who's a surgeon, firefighter, all these things. And he's like, yeah, but you know, I mean, we all know that you're kind of hungry, you know?
All know that your car, we all know that the mommy's car only goes to the grocery store. Yeah. You don't have
a real job. We all know what your real job is. So I think every time that conversation comes up, I, you know, and of course age appropriately, but like with my 6 year old, I can't have, sometimes he would say things like, there's, you know, this girl who has short hair. And I was like, wait, look at my hair. Do I have short hair? He was like, yeah. I was like, and I'm a girl? I was like, yeah. So, and the same in this, the other side, and I was like, oh, you know, because boys don't wear makeup. And I was like, that's not true. No, boys can't wear makeup. Like, you know, that's true. They can. They just like don't as much as girls. But like, you can wear makeup. Like, you can't because you're a child. But if you grow up, like, you can. Right. I don't care. Right. So I think it is our responsibility to create the new generation of men who are not going to just do all that has been done just because it's the way things are being done, and they're gonna actually go like, hey, is this really how we want to, you know, keep going with this? Because like, why do you want to have all the work and all the power to yourself? That makes no sense.
Right.
Like, it's so much better if you share it. There's more people.
Exactly.
To work 60 hours a week. Like, what is, what?
Exactly. Exactly. And I recognize now that my son will be, he'll be 20. He's a Libra as well. So his birthday is October 10th. And so he is approaching, you know, manhood in a sense. He's leaving behind all the teens. And it's so interesting to observe him as a almost man. And, you know, he likes to wear nail polish. He likes to color his hair. He dresses really eccentrically. He's definitely, I would say, a feminist, you know, in his own right. And he's a film student down in New Orleans, and he built an organization for filmmakers. And 80% of the people that are in charge are women. And so just kind of like sitting back and just kind of watching him, I'm like, wow, I told you guys I was onto something. I told you I was onto something, you know?
So yeah, I wholeheartedly agree that I think we, particularly as moms, we do have a responsibility to really smash that patriarchal mindset, not only in our own minds, but also really address it as early as it starts to show up in our children's minds. You know, whether it's I have a niece who's almost three, and then I have three nephews that are under three, and just in conversations with them, observing their parents, kind of seeing like, okay, so we're having a birthday party, and what's the theme of the birthday party? You know, like what's the expectation here? But I love what you said about just giving the kids an acknowledgement, a celebration, and giving them something sweet to eat without going over the top to celebrate a whole lot of whatever. Because I think sometimes when we get into those traditions, with those traditions come some of those mindsets that actually imprint on our kids. And by the time they do get to school age, they've already gotten some stuff in their mind that says, well, I'm supposed to be this. I'm supposed to not be that. This is the only way to be this. This is the only way to be that. And I think it really limits their ability to just kind of figure their stuff out on their own. You know, I was always that mom, like, what do you feel like eating for dinner? What do you want, you know, to wear today? What is your favorite kind of music? You know, like
Yeah, that is amazing because like it's more work to do that, but it's just so much better. Right. And I feel like my oldest, his mindset is very much like, oh my gosh, everything's a disaster. And oh, that was hard. Oh, my life is over because of this. You know, this everything is like just very mindset. And when he started school, I talked to him a lot about these things and about failure and about making mistakes and all that. And I see that, you know, the other day he was like, oh, it started crying. He's very emotional. I was like, why are you crying? He's like, oh, I have no friends, which is totally not true. I was like, oh, yeah, why do you think that? And, you know, he's like, oh, I think he's way taller than the other kids. He is a super nerd when a lot of the kids in his class are super sportive and all that stuff. So it's like, and I'm just telling him that it was like, hey, you know what? Not every single person is going to be your friend. Not every person is going to love you like we do.
Right.
You know, some people are going to not like you for reasons that don't even exist sometimes, but it's fine. I was like, okay, do not pay any attention to those people. Like, forget about them.
Those are
They're
not your
not your
friends.
people.
Yeah, those are not your people.
Yeah, I was just like, ignore them, you know? Because, like, if you think about it, do you like everyone? He's like, no. I'm like, yeah, exactly. So that's totally fine,
Right.
right? So, like, focus on the friends you do have. And then, of course, because I didn't want to be like, oh, of course you have friends. So,
Of
you know,
course.
so you have a conversation. But at some point, the conversation is like, so, you know, how about this person? It's like, oh, yeah, no, he's my friend. So, you know, and then you kind of like make them see that it's not exactly that. But I think most importantly, to like, you're not going to please everyone. You're not going to be everyone's friend. You're going, some people are going to think whatever they're going to think about you. And that's okay. Because I didn't learn that until really like in my 40s, right? You're like, oh, it's fine to
I
please
feel like
everyone.
I just learned that like 3 years ago.
Exactly. Right, which is so it's just such a freeing thing. And now I see, you know, the TikToks and the memes and whatever about the Generation X people who are doing. I was like, I don't know what it is because in Brazil it was different than, you know, the latchkey key. I was not a latchkey but kid by any stretch of the imagination. We had nannies because that's what happens in Brazil. But my mother and my father were not there like catering to me. It's like, oh, shush, sit down and eat. Like, don't, you know, you're not that important, right? Like, which was how it was. So you're just like, you grow up like, oh, okay. And you try to make everybody happy. And then at some point, you're like, you can't. You just can't. It's not going to happen.
It's not
And I
even.
think the moment you notice that, and I don't know if it's an age thing, I think it definitely helps when you turn 40 something at some point. But just the freedom that comes with the fact of really not caring, of really being able to just like, no, this is, I am like this. And not to be an asshole, but you know,
Yeah.
if there are things that you are and you know that people in your family or your friends are not necessarily going to approve, first of all, you have the option of not sharing with them.
Right.
Or if you will, if something that needs to be shared, some people are not going to approve and you need to be ready to, you know, just not have a close relationship with that, those people.
Right. Yeah, I think it, I feel like age and maturity, self-awareness, I think those all can kind of contribute to getting to that place where you realize the effort and energy and time that you put into trying to be liked by everyone was just a fool's effort. It was a fool's journey. There was no way that everyone is not going to be liked by everyone. And I had to learn that as well. And it did take some time, you know, being I'm the oldest of five kids, and, you know, I have, you know, younger siblings, and I was really involved in this and that and school and cheerleading and debate team and all this kind of stuff, and really focused on getting this external validation. Like, I'm good, right? I'm good enough, right? Right. Yeah, yes. Yeah. I'm okay. Right. And then recognizing at a later stage in life, like, this is exhausting to try to be likable all the time instead of just.
And the other thing is that you mentioned external validation, which is like, I actually just wrote a post about this today, which is like, it doesn't matter how much external validation you have. If you don't know yourself, first of all, because a lot of us really don't, like, you don't know what you want. You don't, like, who you are really at your core. You know, all the ideas that your parents, society, whatever, school had for you, but you don't know, is this really who I am and what I want to do? Is this really what I want to do? Married, have kids, have a job? That's not for everyone. Like, why would you have to do that? You don't, right? So maybe I want to go travel the world and not ever have kids. Like, who says that's a thing that you have to do? But once you know this, and then you can make your decisions and then be like, yeah, I don't care what people think. I'm sure of it. But until that point, no matter how many people shower you with love and say how amazing you are, you're still going to have that, but I don't know, maybe just be nice. Like, it doesn't really do anything for you. Once you do have all the trust, then yes, then it's nice. It's like, oh, cool. Yeah, sure. I received that. And yes, I am amazing. Thank you very much. But, you know, like, until that point, it just feels like, I think it actually feeds imposter syndrome even more, because you're just like, oh my God, am I thinking all of that? And I'm so not that. Oh God, when they discover, it's going to be so bad.
Exactly. That's such a notable thing, because we often talk about imposter syndrome being like this lack of belief in ourselves or uncertainty about what we're capable of coming from this internal place. But if we're operating in the mindset of, I need to be likable and I need to do whatever it is so that I can be likable by everyone, then of course we're imposters. We're out there doing things that we don't really believe in, saying things that we don't really mean, and showing up in places we really don't want to be just to be likable. Hell yeah. In that case, we are full on imposters. You know, like,
yeah, I love that.
It's not a syndrome. At that point, that's exactly what we're doing. Yeah.
That is so good. True.
Yeah. One of the questions I like to ask folks is a little bit about their astrology to get some insight. And I by no means am an astrologist, but I've always had an interest in astrology. And so I always ask my guests what their moon, sun, and rising signs are. And I see that you have air across the board, Gemini, Aquarius, and Libra. What is that like? Like, I can just imagine, like, the eccentric, the movement, the creativity, like...
So, full disclosure, I know nothing about astrology. I do know my signs, I know the information, but I don't know anything what that means. What I can say is something I always heard my whole life is my friend saying, oh my gosh, like, you never know what to expect with you. And not in a bad way, because I know Geminis have that, you know, but it's just like, I consider myself a really serious person and the goofiest person ever. I think I'm very smart and so dumb sometimes. I see all these things in me and, like, fine with it. I'm totally okay with that, all of that. And definitely always doing, you know, like, oh, there's this thing that interests, okay, I'm just gonna go do it. Like, you know, let's try it out. Like, maybe it's not gonna work, but, you know, I'm gonna try it out and see what happens. Right. And even I saw a meme today that was something about, like, it was an astrology thing. It was like a roller coaster. One person was, hey! The other one was like, oh my God. So the wee person was like, Sagittarius, when they think about moving to another country without any plans or income. And he's like, wee. And the other guy was like, so stressed, is like, whatever else, take a new route to work. And I was like, I'm neither of those things, but I'm completely that person. I literally did that. I moved overseas with a toddler and a newborn without a job, having no clue what's gonna happen. And here we are, everything worked fine. I was like, yeah, of course, I knew it, you know? And
I knew
my husband is the same. So we're just like, this year was like, oh, let's spend summer in Colorado. I was like, yeah, why not? Sure, let's Airbnb our house and let's go. And people are like, oh, how'd you do that? I'm like, we literally decide. Mm-hmm. Then we plan, we go, get in the car and drive.
And just go for it. Yeah.
So I feel like there is that, I mean, and spontaneous, not like, oh yeah, let's go and like go now, you know, like I do, I like having things somewhat planned for sure, but not like, oh yeah, let's, you know, exhaust our, you know, let's think about this for 5 years and then we'll go. It was just like, no, let's try it out. And maybe it's not going to work. And sometimes it doesn't, because like a lot of times taking trips with small kids, which we do a lot, it's like, well, that was not fun.
Right. Won't do that again, but okay. We wouldn't know if we didn't try. We wouldn't know if we didn't try. Yeah. I feel like so many of us spend so much time operating with cautious minds that we really just toss passion, adventure, curiosity, just get kind of tossed out the window. But we encourage our kids to be curious and use your imagination and be creative. But then for whatever reason, at some point, we like silence that part of our minds that said creativity, adventure, imagination is only for the youth. And then when we get to become like, yeah, and I think
it's
adult, like
for whatever reason, I think it's the adult thing. It's exactly like, oh, you know, being an adult means you're going to have a 401k and you're going to save and you're going to X and Y and Z and you're not going to spend money like a crazy person and, you know, not going to get in debt. Oh my God, debt's the worst thing that you could possibly do. And honestly, even that, I'm like, if you have debt, because for instance, if you wanna, I don't know, take a course or do something that you really, or hire a coach, like seriously, I think it's like, it's the best thing you can do in your life. If you're gonna get into, I don't know, debt because of that, but that is gonna give you stuff in your life that you're gonna take forever and ever. It's just money. Money is a made up thing. It's not even, you know, it's like a bunch of zeros and ones in a computer. It's not even like the real thing anymore, right? So it's just like, you can make more of that. You can make more of your time. You can, like, there are these things, whenever your kids are grown, you lost their childhood. If you're working a million hours a week, mm-hmm. Dad was like that. He was a great dad. Like, I don't know if he would be a great dad if he was there all the time. He wasn't. Because he was working the whole time. We would take vacations and he would not go with us because he had to work. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. Maybe I would, now that he's not here anymore, I'm like, you know what? I would trade some money that he made for his actual presence with us, you know? So okay. I think that would be much more worth for me than, oh, here's a new toy or whatever it is.
Right.
So I think we put so much. And I think one thing that once you realize that you actually pay for things with your time much more than anything else, not money, mm-hmm. not that you're going to become crazy and just like spend money, like, but like, does give you some flexibility instead of like, I know people, I had consults with people that would say, oh, this is too expensive. Mm-hmm. And first of all, it's not that expensive. And second of all, they had just told me how much, like some people would say, oh yeah, no, I have this, you know, cause I have this much in savings and whatever. Like, what are you saving for? If not to do this, which is like to improve your life.
Right.
What is that for? And then it's like a based on fear kind of thing. Oh, I have to save because if something goes wrong, like, whoa, if something goes wrong, then you figure it out, right? Like, you don't have to do all the things waiting for something to go wrong, like for not living because one day you're going to die. And just sit in your house and like wait for it to
die. Exactly.
Makes sense to me at all.
No, it doesn't. It really doesn't. And I think it's so interesting because I think a part of it is also has a cultural influence, a cultural context to it. Because when I've gone to different parts of the world, different parts of the world versus different parts of this country, and just seeing how different people live. Like I went to Fiji years ago and was there for like 10 days and, you know, left the resort and went and hung out with some of the people who actually worked at the resort who were locals. And to just see like their vibe, they're living, they're thriving, they're having families, they're inspired, they're empowered, they're happy, you know, they're joyful, they're spending time outdoors. And I'm thinking, wow, I don't know anybody in America who lives like this, you know, like, I don't even know.
That's so true. And in Brazil is the same thing. You see that a lot. And I think it makes me think about that. There was this one story, the guy goes to the beach and saw the fisherman and the fisherman's like doing his thing. And it's like, oh, you should, you know, hire people or do whatever, blah, blah, blah. Starts giving him advice. He's like, why would I do that? Oh, so then you can do, you know, basically was like, yeah, grow your business. I was like, but what would I do with that? I was like, oh, so then you can spend time doing whatever you want. And he's like, yeah, this is what I want. That's what I'm doing right now. So I don't need a bunch of money to do this.
Exactly.
Like, maybe that's true. And I think in our society it's just like, so the same way it's like, oh, you're a woman, of course you want to get married and have kids.
Right.
Which is absolutely not true. And then whomever decides to not do that, you have to, there's going to be people that are going to say, oh, you're going to change your mind. Oh, of course. Mm-hmm. Or oh, we got this, or whatever the crap they want to say, which mm-hmm. might even be true. Maybe it would. I changed my mind. I didn't want to know I have want to have kids until I did. Mm-hmm. But that's not true for everyone. And some people really, why would you have kids? Why would you do that? If it's, there's nothing about this that calls for you, just go do right. something else.
Right.
The same with, you know, why you want to, not everyone wants to grow their business and make millions of dollars. Some people just want to have, you know, a life that they work like 3 hours a day and go walk in the park or kayak all day. I don't know. Right. So it's like, I think this is so like the unconscious kind of thing. If you don't stop and you're like, wait, again, who am I? What do I want? And all these questions, that you can actually live the life that you want to live instead of just the life that's kind of default.
Like, yeah.
All these boxes. Oh, wait, those are not my box. Damn it. No, I have all
I
of
love
this,
that.
I'm still unhappy.
Yes. Those are not my boxes. Oh my God. That is so good. Those are not my boxes. There's so many times when, especially in conversation with other women, where, like you said, they're kind of, oh, I'm about to turn 30, I'm about to turn 40, I'm about to turn this. Let me pull out my boxes and start checking things off. And if I didn't check those things off, then I got to put them on my bucket list so I do them before I die. And I'm like, those are not my boxes. My list yeah. doesn't look like that. You know, my list looks a lot different. My list looks more like, let's do it right now. Let's do how many things I can do on this list today. What's the thing that's on my quote unquote end of life bucket list that I can actually implement now? So no, this is valuable. We're going to switch gears for a minute as we move into the second part of this conversation. And this is where I like to do a couple things, like to ask you some interesting questions. And then we're going to do a section called complete the sentence, where I'm going to give you some sentence prompts and you kind of fill them in and take up as much space as you'd like. And at the very end, I have a little visualization that we're going to do together. So to get us started, I have this really cool deck of cards, and it's a deck of cards that's invited into conversation to kind of encourage conversation. So the card that I pulled for you today says, if everyone had to decide on their career path at age 6, what would your life look like now?
Whoa. I don't even know. What did I want? I think I wanted to be a veterinarian.
Okay.
So I think I would have fun being a vet. I love animals.
Well, there you go. I see the chimpanzee in the background on your wall.
Know, exactly. Yeah. No, I love it. And it was funny because for a long time I was like, I never connected the being a vet with being a doctor. Mm-hmm. I was like, no, I think I wanted to be a vet because I liked animals. It was not about the medicine part. It was just like, I just want to be around it. Because then I have the oceanographer thing and whatever. Like, there was like several other things that involved different animals in different parts of the world. But in the end, my grandfather, before he died, he told me something. I was like, no, you were the only grandchild. And he has like 30, because my dad had a bunch of brothers and all of them had a bunch of kids. Mm-hmm. No, you were the only grandchild that actually wanted to go see a cow give birth. I was like, oh, of course I wanted to say, why don't people want to see that? That's amazing. That's of course I wanted to. So, you know, maybe I did already like that stuff when I was a kid. So I think it would be all right.
Interesting. Interesting. I like that. So one of the questions I ask also is, if you woke up, we were just talking about money. If you woke up tomorrow with $100 million in your bank account, what is the first thing you would do?
Dance party. Celebrate. Like, oh yeah.
Right.
For sure.
I'll take that. I've had so many different responses to that question. Some, you know, most everyone says celebrate. A couple folks said, you know, restart the app and make sure it's accurate. You know, like, make sure this is me, mine. Okay. I think of like the game Monopoly, like bank error in your favor. Make sure that it's correct. So we're going to move into complete the sentence. So I'm going to give you a couple sentences and you can just complete them however you'd like. The first one is, I am happiest when.
I am happiest when I'm actually listening to myself. That means all different, as we established, I do things in different times of day sometimes. On the same day, I'm just like, oh, it's like a different person every hour of the day. So I think whenever I can move about my day listening to that, mm-hmm. I think everything is so much better. And even sometimes, like this week, I had that. I think it was yesterday. I woke up and for some reason, I was not feeling great. I was feeling just like, I don't know, sad, anxious, weird, something, you know, something. I mean, my 4-year-old would be crazy. And it's just like sometimes a fight. And, you know, like even though you try all the bells and whistles to make him do whatever, at some point, you just have to get in the damn car and go to school. You know? Right. So he left with my husband, like screaming and crying after we did like a 1-hour song and dance for him. And I was like, oh my gosh. And just so I just like, I didn't have anything planned for the morning. So I just like, you know what? I'm just going to have a good cry. And then I talked to a friend, I called my mom, I rested. And then by the middle of the day, it was fine. And then I was like, oh, now I'm going to do some work. And then I did some work. And then by the rest, you know, the rest of the afternoon was fine. It was amazing. And then I went on with my husband on the date at night. So it was like, you know, that flow, which people might say, oh, but you're privileged because you can do it. Yeah, I can because I chose it.
Yeah.
Exactly. So when I was a doctor, I couldn't do any of that, of course. I could be feeling however I was feeling. I was like, chop, chop, let's go.
Right.
So I think, you know, one of the things that I wanted when I changed careers, like I want to be able to do that. I want to be able to have, and of course I have responsibilities. We have time scheduled and here I am, right?
Right.
But mostly I do allow a lot of flexibility so that I can do that. So I can follow whatever is inspiring to do that.
Yeah. I like that. I appreciate that. Privilege takes a lot of different forms and flexibility is part of that. But like you said, the decisions that we make to maybe let go or release one type of privilege can afford us an opportunity for an entirely different one that has more value, you know, depending on what stage of our lives that we're in, you know?
Yeah. One thing, I was in this group of physicians looking for non-clinical careers, because of course I was one, you know, at some point. And then I just see people miserable in that group. And there's like thousands of people in that group. And then one day I ask a question, say, hey, genuine question. Mm-hmm. If you're really unhappy with medicine, why don't you quit? And hundreds of answers, most of them were related to money.
Yep.
Most of them are like, I have too much debt. I can't because of my salary. Because they're... And then I wrote a post in this group. I'm like, okay, listen, first of all, I cried reading the answers to this post because it was super depressing.
Right.
But also, listen, that is not true that you cannot leave a job as a doctor, being a doctor, because you have debt. You know what you can do? It might mean you have to sell your fancy house, your fancy car, and you might have to get a job that's below you. Mm-hmm. I did. I worked as a medical translator and it was like, oh my gosh. I was like, whatever, dude. That's what I'm going to do because I'm not going to do that thing anymore. You know, so it might require you to change that mindset. Like, mm-hmm. No, but like, I'm a doctor. I can't just go work at Starbucks. Why not?
You're not. Right. You're going to be great at Starbucks. You're going to be.
Yeah. That means that you're going to have, you know, a different kind of life. Totally, that makes sense. Like, that makes no sense. Like, why do you need all these things? That maybe some people, it's, you know, for some people it may be really important, but like for some people it's really not. And it's, you just have that because it's kind of a the whole validation thing.
Right.
So just looking at these things like very honestly with yourself and really what are the things you want? Because like, okay, so now you're going to be stuck in this job that you hate and you hate life. Because I cannot tell you how many people said I cry in the parking lot every day. Like that specific thing
when yeah.
It happened a million times. And I was like, so you prefer to be crying your Mercedes in the parking lot instead of driving your Camry to get this beautiful vacation with your family or friends or whatever. That makes no sense. Stop it.
Exactly. Stop that. Exactly. That's no. Yeah. Now you're not sounding like an educated physician. Now you're sounding exactly. Like someone else. Yeah. Now you're sounding like someone else. The next one I have for you is, I know I've made an impact when.
I have so many. Okay. So I thought about like some of my kids and some of my clients. I think one of my favorites, if I'm not thinking about my kids specifically, but with my clients is when they mention something that their kids did because of the way, like because of the work they did with me, or, you know, it's like not because of me, but like, because they invested in themselves, the time, the money.
Right.
To make those changes. And also, you know, it's hard. I'm not going to say it was like, you know, personal development is so fun. Yay. No, it's not. It's really not. It feels like you're dying a lot of times.
Yeah.
But it's really worth it. And then you see, you know, sometimes someone say, oh, you know, like, my daughter today, like there's a friend of mine who told the story. She said, my daughter went to Starbucks and she's very anxious. She doesn't talk to strangers and all that. And mm-hmm. there's just one drink that she drinks every day and she loves it, blah, blah, blah. And she went there and the drink wasn't good and she was frustrated. And I was like, why didn't you ask for another one? And I'm like, oh, I couldn't. So one day she goes and she actually does ask for the other, for the people to, because they don't care. Like, we know that, right? Like, they, of course, they need like 15 drinks for you. They don't give a shit. But the fact that she was, it was like, oh, this was super brave. And I did it because it was inspired by seeing, you know, her mom doing that work. It's just like, because that's honestly, I think that's how we change the world. Like, I believe truly that my work changed the world because of that, because it's not just you. Mm-hmm. When I was a surgeon, like, you know, I know that by changing this one person's life, by taking away her cancer, her family is going to change, because this is an experience that is going to change everyone. And then, you know, it's going to change her kids. It's going to change her friends. And it's the same with coaching. So I think that is the thing that, you know, whenever all of us know how amazing we are and act on that, mm-hmm. you know, that's what we're going to pass on. And that's why the world's going to be different.
Yeah, I agree. Wholeheartedly agree with that. So we're going to take a moment before we close out, and we're just going to do a little visualization so you can get comfortable. Take a couple of deep breaths. If you'd like to close your eyes, you can. And you're just going to imagine yourself getting into a time machine that looks however you want. And you're going to go all the way back until you were 16. And when you step out of this time machine, the first person that you see is your 16-year-old self. What do you say to her?
Trust yourself. Because, oh my God, that girl, like, she had, like, she listened to everybody else so long. And I think one thing, especially if you're a person who is different than your parents in a lot of ways, and I think mm-hmm. I had that with my mom specifically. Mm-hmm. And again, because my dad, you know, was working all the time. And again, he was amazing, but working all the time. So, and with my mom, I was like, even silly things like she loves 5-star hotels. And I mean, I have nothing against 5-star hotels. I think they're great, but I also love going to a shack on the beach, at the beach. And that was always kind of you're just doing this to be rebellious. And I remember having this conversation when I was 40 with her. It's like, I am 40. I'm not being rebellious. I actually prefer this other thing. Because they were all going to Paris in this trip. And I was in Hawaii in the jungle. This is the hippie community. I'm like, no, I actually want to stay in Paris on a full day booked. Like, they were like paying for everything. I'm like, no, cool here.
I don't want that. Yeah. I don't want to do that.
If you trust yourself, you know, and you're like, no, it's okay. Like, not to be a fight, but just like, you know what? Even mm-hmm. if they don't understand, mm-hmm. it's still fine that you think yes. differently. And you can, if that comes from like your self-knowledge, mm-hmm. you know, that's true for you. It's okay.
Agreed. Trust yourself. That's a good one. So before we go, I have one last thing for you. I've been working with this Oracle deck. It's called the Oracle of E. And I've been working with this since I started the podcast, 2018. And so it's just a deck of 52 Oracle cards. So I just would like you to pick a number between 1 and 52.
19?
Yeah. Okay. So these are fun, like clever messages. So the message for number 19 is bazinga. It's an exclamation. It's an exclamation. But the message is, well, 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 don't you have it going on? Now's the time to reveal in the sweet taste of fantabulous you. Soak it in, sip it in. You've hit your mark. Go on. Take a victory lap. Pop a cork. Let's get this party started. Celebrants are waiting at your door.
That is amazing. I love
it. It's basically like, you are a badass and everybody knows it. So go ahead and let yourself be celebrated. So
that is awesome.
Thank you. So Manuela, this has been such a great conversation. I really appreciate your time. And just, you know, I feel like I've learned so much. I've laughed so much. I feel like you and I definitely are operating
in a similar wavelength in this world as moms. I'm 44 as well this year, and I got an early start on the mom thing, but I've learned that we never stop being parents. You know, as long as there's breath in our lungs, we're still parenting one way or another. And I just think what you're doing and really taking the initiative to focus your attention and your energy on really nurturing and coaching other women to just be amazing moms in their own right is such a powerful task that you've taken on. And I just want to affirm you and commend you for doing that work.
Thank you. I receive that.
Yeah. You're awesome. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So people can find you on social, or let us know how people can get in touch with you.
Sure. Well, my website is manuelapowell.com, and all my info is there if you want to explore working one-on-one with me, or my Facebook group is also there. The link is called the Audacious Motherhood Society. You don't have to be a mom, but you do have to identify as a woman. And I'm in all the things, all the social media as Dr. Manuela Powell. Please go find me. Say hi. I'd love that.
Yay. Yes. Go check her out if you haven't already. I think I'll be joining your Facebook group ASAP because I can't wait to get into those conversations. So yeah, this has been a pleasure. I appreciate you, and just enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you.
Thank you so much. This was so fun.
Okay. Have a good one. Peace.
You too.